Derivatives began in 1983 for me when I was 12 years old and saw the film Trading Places with Eddie Murphy and Dan Aykroyd. The plot revolves around an upper-class commodities futures broker who ends up switching places with a tramp when they both become the underlying assets in a complex wager, before, in the end, turning the tables on their tormentors. I know that I am not the only derivatives lawyer that holds that film dear, but derivatives goes back much further, with organized futures trading markets existing at least 4,000 years ago in ancient Mesopotamia, with later forms of derivatives markets existing in the ancient Middle East, before reappearing in Amsterdam, Bruges, London and Tokyo in the 17th and 18th centuries, and the American, European and Asian markets after that. Asset classes such as commodities, equities and FX were all traded in some of these eras too. I'm Edmund Parker. I'm Global Co-Head of Derivatives and Structured Products at Mayer Brown. I was the sole author of the book Credit Derivatives, Documenting and Understanding Credit Derivatives Products, as well as creating, editing and co-editing two other books in this trilogy on equity derivatives and commodity derivatives. I've always had a keen interest in history, and outside of being a lawyer, I devour history books, and my cupboards are full of DVDs and history TV series, and I get that from my father, Professor Geoffrey Parker.
I'm Geoffrey Parker. I teach history at The Ohio State University in Columbus, Ohio. I was 40 when I first watched Trading Places. Really enjoyed the movie. Didn't understand the concept. That took me another 30 years. I usually live in the 16th and the 17th centuries, writing biographies of unsuccessful kings like Philip II and depressing studies of climate-induced catastrophes. In 2012, the Royal Dutch Academy of Sciences awarded me the biennial Heineken Prize for History. I'm a fellow of the British Academy, the Spanish Real Academia de la Historia, and the KNAV, the Royal Dutch Academy of Sciences, and I've written over 40 books. Those of you who studied A-level history may even have had to read my book, Europe in Crisis, as a set text.
We used to joke that the global audience with an interest in both our respective fields was narrow indeed. Once I received an email from a lawyer at one of the leading Spanish law firms telling me that not only had he enjoyed reading my credit derivatives book, but he had also just finished your latest work on Philip II. And we speculated that this was an audience of one in the world. But that got me thinking. Derivatives does have a rich history, and its role in securing resources, securing prices, providing an opportunity to speculate and invest are nothing new.
I remember when the financial crisis happened and derivatives were taking all the blame. And I thought, derivatives, isn't that what my son does? And the question that many who were at that stage unfamiliar with the product asked was, what is a derivative? Well, what is a derivative? Why would you ever want one?
Okay, up on screen now is my definition of a derivative. I put variations of this chart into my three principal books and the foundation lectures I give on derivatives from time to time. So here's my definition. A derivative is a financial instrument referencing an underlying asset or other variable from which the financial instrument's price or value is derived, entered into by the parties for a purpose. This is a bit of a mouthful, but by setting out the definition in this way, we show that a derivative contract is made up of four constituent parts. These are a financial instrument referencing an underlying asset or other variable from which the financial instrument's price or value is derived and entered into by the parties for a purpose. This allows us to analyze each constituent part in turn to form a fuller picture of the nature of derivatives. The financial instrument, the first constituent part, will fall into one of three main categories of derivative financial instrument. These are OTC, or over-the-counter derivatives, or derivatives cleared through a central counterparty, structured products, and exchange-traded products. In the case of an OTC or cleared derivative, the financial instrument will be a swap, a forward, or an option. In the case of a structured product, it will be a note, certificate, warrant, fund unit, or a bespoke swap. In the case of an exchange-traded product, it will be a future, an option, or one of the structured products. The section constituent part, the underlying asset or other variable, will be an asset such as bullion, metals, agricultural products, freight prices, paper, gas, power, emissions allowances, or a weather or share index, or it may be a share, an interest rate, foreign exchange risk, or credit instrument. The price or value of the underlying asset from which the financial instrument derives its value, the third constituent part, may be the change in the price or of an underlying commodity or future referencing it, or the level of an index over a period of time, or between specific dates. Alternatively, it may be the relative price or level of different underlying assets over a period of time or specific dates, or the total return on single or multiple underlying assets, for example, indices or futures contracts over a period of time. These prices or levels may be determined on specific or multiple dates and often in accordance with a formula. The fourth constituent part, the purpose for which the parties enter into a derivative transaction, can be many and varied. And these reasons might include commodity producers, such as mining companies looking to hedge against sale proceeds being insufficient to cover production costs. It could be property developers wanting to hedge floating rate loans with a fixed rate. Or it could be manufacturers hedging against rises in raw material prices which would erode their sale margins. It could be speculators making leveraged investments in shares, or indeed it could be funds looking to diversify their investments in pools of equities and shares. So it's clear from the slide what uses derivatives have in the modern world: hedging of fixed against floating rate interest, protecting against adverse movements in currencies, locking in prices of jet fuel, protecting against declines in creditworthiness, or speculating in or investing in alternative asset streams. Clear, quite clear for modern day industrial times. But looking through our slide though, which earlier civilizations had sufficient financial infrastructure to allow derivatives to flourish? Several people writing about the history of derivatives have tried to take events described in the Bible or early writing as evidence of a derivative transaction. One I saw plucked a tale from Aristotle about forward sale of olive presses to herald this as an example. I don't buy those as evidence of a derivatives market any more than a system of signal torches around the English coastline in the 16th century shows that warning of the arrival of the Spanish Armada in 1588 came by telephone. I don't think we should take certain commercial transactions which have features of modern day derivatives as being early evidence of derivatives, unless they were accompanied by markets. So what we are looking for is evidence of derivative markets in earlier times, and the earliest derivatives market on record is in ancient Mesopotamia at around 2000 BC.
That's right. Although humans just like you and me, well, just like me anyway, have existed on Earth for the past 50,000 years, it's not until they start living in large groups that we find the two vital preconditions for derivatives: communities so large that they cannot feed themselves without importing goods, and so complex that they invent writing to record, among other things, the arrangements needed to handle these imports. We call this development the Urban Revolution, and it developed in four areas of the globe at much the same time and in very similar environments: the broad river valleys. The first is in Iraq around 3500 BC, the Tigris and Euphrates valleys. The second is Egypt around 3100 BC, the Nile. The third is in Pakistan around 3000, the Indus Valley. And the fourth is North China about 2500 around the Yangtze. The link seems to have been irrigation. These were not the natural habitats of cereals, but they were areas where the floodplains required the inhabitants to make a series of dikes to cope with the unpredictable floodwaters of the great rivers. And with this, farmers produced unprecedented crop surpluses. 5,000 years ago, some Iraqi farmers were getting yields of 60, even 70 grains per grain sown. And that's enough to support kings, nobles, priests, and scribes. And the records of the scribes are what gives us the information we need to evaluate the society, particularly the scribes that worked around this huge temple, the ziggurat of Uruk, the original word for Iraq, on the plains of the Tigris and the Euphrates. Now, I mentioned that Iraq was not the only home of the urban revolution. We also find it in the Nile Valley in what's modern Egypt. We find it in the Indus Valley in what's now Pakistan. And we find it in the Yellow River Valley in North China. In each of these fertile valleys, each one liable to flooding, we find not one but over a dozen cities, each of them with huge buildings, each with thousands of houses arranged in streets around public squares, and each with a complex form of writing. I think these are the environments where we find the birth of derivatives. Would you agree with that?
Yes. We have the rule of law, writing, and we have negotiability and enforceability of contracts. And this allows us to have financial instruments. A forward or future is the most likely financial instrument to develop and be successful in these times. We have the underlying assets too, commodities in the form of grain, and we have the purpose, securing supplies, securing prices, and allowing commercial trading, profit, and speculation in contracts. At the last ISDA conference in Munich this year, I attended a lecture on the social benefits of derivatives, which was given by Professor Christopher Culp. He put resource allocation as the first social benefit of derivatives, stating that derivatives enhance the allocative function of spot prices by facilitating the allocation of the asset underlying the derivatives contract across time and space. And I agree with that.
I agree with that too. I think that there are four principal resource needs in an early society which could be satisfied by derivative contracts: securing supplies, financing agriculture, managing risk, and speculating for profit. You had all of that in ancient Mesopotamia and lots more. Remember, this is a society that invents the plow, the potter's wheel, the sailing boat, the draw loom, copper metallurgy, abstract math, exact astronomical observation, and the calendar. All of them appear in Iraq for the first time in the world around 3000. And the scale of those achievements has few parallels in such a short period. But note this. Around 2000 BC, the states of Iraq merge into one of the first empires of history, one ruled by a king of Babylon called Hammurabi. He's known to us almost entirely through a single artifact, a pillar, on which his scribes engraved the first surviving law code in history, 3,600 lines of law written down in cuneiform. Argument with it really wasn't an option. Look at the top of the pillar. The person sitting on the throne is not, as many suppose, Hammurabi, but God. Hammurabi is the little guy standing humbly before the throne, receiving the laws. And this is exactly where we find the first derivative. Hammurabi's code allows sale of goods and assets to be delivered for an agreed price at a future date, required contracts to be in writing and witnessed, and allowed assignment of contracts. The sanctions for breaking the rules were sufficiently rigid. Death.
You also had plenty of need for this regulation. Temples, in addition to being places of worship, could be commercial hubs, facilitating trading between merchants. For example, buying and selling grain and creating granaries to deposit that grain. Those depositories could also provide for rules for minimum standards of quality and quantity to be met, to allow the grain or other commodity to be deposited there and also to be graded. Let me go to my definition of a forward, which I wrote in my commodity derivatives book. A forward transaction is a bilateral sale and purchase contract. In a physically settled transaction, one of the parties agrees to sell and the other agrees to buy a defined amount of the underlying commodity at a defined point in the future for a specified price. In a cash settled transaction, the parties will instead exchange the difference between the actual trading price of the underlying commodity asset at the future date and the price set out in the confirmation. I would add to that that the ability to assign contracts is the ingredient necessary to create a tradable derivatives market rather than just facilitate derivatives transactions?
Okay, I think we can say that all these constituent parts of a derivatives transaction are present in ancient Mesopotamia. But so is the final piece required to create a market, assignability of contracts, which allows the derivative contract itself to be traded. This gives the derivative contract its intrinsic value. It also allows speculation and liquidity.
Yes, the ingredients are all there. A Mesopotamian farmer or landowner who is paid in grain could sell his grain at an agreed future price to a trading house or connected broker, giving him certainty of profit before growing the grain. And an end user, such as a wholesaler who sold to the bakers, could also agree a future price so that he had certainty of supply should prices rise. And between the farmer and the wholesaler, you had one or more brokers acting as middlemen. The middleman made a forward contact with each of the farmer and the wholesaler, taking either a commission or spread from both of them, i.e. building a book. With standardization of goods, there was no need to deliver the exact commodity delivered by the farmer. Indeed, the wholesaler might not even know the farmer was there. With the ability to assign contracts, a tradable derivatives market was present too. So far, so good. That's how modern-day market makers generate their profits, even today. Ancient Mesopotamia had the conditions and infrastructure for derivatives markets to form a general part of commerce. So, was Mesopotamia alone before the early modern period in having a derivatives market?
Probably not, but it is the only one for which we have an unequivocal written record. Some form of derivatives market involving the forward trading of commodities probably existed in other urban societies that had organized commerce. The rule of contract law, the ability to assign contracts, and the need of securing supplies. You'd expect to see something similar in other ancient world jurisdictions, but we found no records. Ancient Egypt, although a very complex society, does not display a similar commercial environment. There's evidence of forward agreements for the delivery of agricultural products in ancient Israel and Cyprus, but not of a derivatives market. We need to move further along the timeline to find evidence of another derivatives market, like ancient Mesopotamia.
So how much further along the timeline are we talking?
Well, the legal system created by Hammurabi and others continued for at least another 1,000 years, with very little change to the contractual system. And then it was taken over by Greek invaders led by Alexander the Great, who lives between 356 BC and 323 BC. Alexander conquered Egypt and Macedonia and founded at least 250 cities, 70 of them named after him.
Alex seems to have had a bit of an inferiority complex.
Indeed, but Alexander, like all other Greeks, lacked one thing. He didn't know about derivatives. He operated a cash economy. All the Greeks seem to have operated a strictly cash economy. But those who followed Alexander and settled in Mesopotamia soon saw the advantage of contracts for future delivery. And so the concept spread westwards into Greece itself and from there to Rome.
So that takes us to ancient Rome. Here you had a trading empire with sophisticated processes for moving multiple types of commodity assets across the empire, be it grain, olive oil, wine, or slaves. You also had currency, contract law, and writing, and the legacy of Roman law, which still stands to this day. The basics for an active derivatives market appear here too.
Yes, they do. We see some evidence of commodities forwards in use in the 2nd century BC, 2 centuries after Alexander. Some forms of secondary market trading may have existed too, even earlier. But Roman law only provided the constituents for a derivatives market, such as assignment of contracts and sufficiently complex legal structures around the 1st century AD. Then around AD 250, Roman law began to allow assignment of contracts and enforcement of forward derivative contracts. But although there was some trading on a secondary basis, there was not a derivatives market. Following the fall of the Roman Empire in the West, these sorts of contracts continued with trading between Italian merchant cities, but I think that you need to move to Northern Europe to see a real derivatives market develop again.
So, with nothing really happening in the derivatives market during the Dark Ages, we're now really talking your period. So what about the 13th, 14th and 15th centuries?
I'm afraid you're in for another disappointment. It's certainly a period that saw the return of very large cities that couldn't feed themselves without imports, especially in northern Italy and the Netherlands. And it's there that we find the emergence of banks, trading companies, and important new legal instruments that protected merchants who wanted to get rich by buying and selling goods on credit. But that's as far as it gets. The Catholic Church vehemently opposes anything involving interest, speculation or gambling on the future, with one exception. The church ran its own enormous futures market called indulgences. A large workforce of clerics toured Europe offering to laymen and laywomen a certificate called an indulgence that promised in the Pope's name that anyone who made a donation to a pious cause, okay, anyone who made a donation to them in person, would go straight to heaven when they died.
I think I may have spotted an underlying asset which is missing from my definition of derivatives chart. So I think I'll put indulgences right next to Mesopotamian slaves. Are you able at this time to assess, though, the value of this investment in futures?
No. Moreover, I'm not saying that the church's opposition to interest, which it called usury, stop the practice of lending, because thousands of contracts that promised to repay loans at more than face value have survived, and hundreds of merchants got extremely rich from lending. But the church's hostility did force merchants to be discreet, clandestine, and circumspect. There was no way for a market in futures and securities to develop. It would be tempting to say that the Protestant Reformation, which began in the 1520s as a protest against indulgences, changed this game. But in fact, it was the reformer's greatest enemy, the Emperor Charles V, a staunch Catholic who ruled the Netherlands, as well as half of Europe and large parts of America, who took the decisive steps. In the 1530s, even as he barbecued hundreds of Protestants, he signed legislation that recognized the legality of assignment of contracts for forward delivery of commodity assets. And this gave support and encouragement to a tradable market in derivative contracts rather than in just the underlying commodities. So, for perhaps the first time since ancient Mesopotamia, in the Netherlands in the 1530s, you have a contract market. The church immediately realized what had happened. Just listen to this Spanish cleric writing only 6 years after the legislation enacted by Charles V. Of late in Flanders, a horrible thing has arisen, a kind of cruel tyranny which the merchants have invented among themselves. They wager among themselves on the rate of exchange in the Spanish fairs at Antwerp. One wagers that the exchange rate shall be 2%. Premium or discount, another 3%, etc. They promise each other to pay the difference in accordance with the result. This is a great sin.
So we have our first evidence of FX derivatives. Our regulators are at this very moment trying to clamp down on the great sins which have been committed in this market in the last few years.
Well, it may have been a sin in the 16th century, but it was one that merchants all over Northwest Europe were willing and eager to commit. The practice spread from Antwerp to Amsterdam to Hamburg to Danzig and to London.
So we have evidence of commodity derivatives, evidence of FX derivatives, and about this time, the birth of equity markets in the very financial centres you mentioned. The conditions are there for not only a complex financial market, but for the birth of an equity derivatives market and a more sophisticated commodity derivatives market.
In each of these new financial centres, you find a speculation in the shares of privately owned companies, what we call joint stock companies, of which the most famous and the most traded were the shares of companies that specialized in long-distance commodity trade, like the East India companies. You also find contracts for differences, options on future commodities, and short sales of commodities by sellers who did not own the underlying commodity, all to get rich. Of course, most of the commodities were either essentials like grain, fish, wine, or wool, or high-value goods like precious metals and spices. But people could and did make wages on anything. The most famous was the tulip bulb. Tulips are native to the Eastern Mediterranean and only became common in Europe in the late 16th century. They produce, of course, flowers of spectacular beauty in lots of different colors, but it takes several years to grow a flowering bulb, any bulb, from a seed.
How long?
Oh, you can produce an ordinary bulb in 1 or 2 years, but growing an exotic one like this could take 7, 9, even 12 years. Moreover, however ordinary or exotic, in Northern Europe, a tulip blooms for a maximum of 2 weeks. Afterwards, for about 3 months, they're dormant, and you can dig them up and move them safely.
Aha, so you have the perfect conditions for a commodity derivative. You have a durable commodity whose exact future value cannot be determined, but can still be traded.
And that's just what happened. As tulips became more exotic, the demand for them rose. By 1636, the tulip bulb was the fourth most important export of the Netherlands. But of course, given the nature of the plant, supply could never keep pace with demand, and so we find a fully-fledged futures market. Traders held regular meetings to buy and sell contracts for the next season's bulbs, while growers conducted spot sales or signed notarized futures sales. It's said that some bulbs changed hands 10 times in a single day. Nevertheless, since the commodity didn't yet exist, the Dutch themselves called the trade a windhandel.
Trading hot air, perhaps.
Very good. Yes, but it's very expensive hot air. Over the winter of 1636 to 7, the price of some bulbs include 30 folds, until the price of some surpassed a craftsman's wages for a whole year. And then, very suddenly, one day no more buyers appeared at a futures meeting. Those who the previous day had paid a staggering sum for a bulb future found no buyer, but were left with a contract obliging them to make the agreed payment at the agreed date.
So by the mid-17th century, we are at least back to where we were in ancient Mesopotamia. We now have global trade, much greater sophistication and enforceability of contracts, assignment, and a strong merchant and trading class. We also have companies limited by shares. We have competition between trading markets demonstrated by England and Holland. Forward trading of commodities on a negotiable basis is in place. We also have laws for the regulation of brokers in place in both Antwerp and London. We also have the development of a class of speculators called jobbers. The jobbers would buy up an underlying commodity asset, say wheat, and wait for prices to rise through scarcity. They were able to move into forward and future trading, though, through the standardization of commodity markets, i.e. allowing contracts to be settled through delivery of a standard grading of the commodity rather than delivery of the specific asset. The jobbers were accompanied by factors. Factors acted as brokers, i.e. middlemen, buying and selling commodity assets between end users for commission. Some of these brokers started to buy up the underlying asset they traded to control prices and then sell the asset on. The existence of classes of businessmen like this aided the development of a commodity derivatives market, and a commodity futures market developed in wool and cloth. So tell me about the state of world trade in the 18th century and the major financial centres.
The 18th century is when the Industrial Revolution begins, starting in Great Britain, beginning in earnest from about 1760. This is accompanied by an emerging global economy, and by the second half of the century, you've trading connections between America, Asia, and Europe, making an important contribution to wealth. Between 1702 and 1772, Britain's already healthy foreign trade trebled. The foreign trade of France, which started, of course, from a lower base, increased eightfold. This trade required transportation of goods over large distances, mainly by ship. It also required the support of a financial system. So before the Industrial Revolution really gets going, you've strong conditions, foundations, if you wish, for the growth of a derivatives market.
That explosion in world trade was accompanied by the progression, development, and sophistication of the rule of law. Shipping held the world economy together. In fact, it still holds the world economy together, with over 90% of internationally traded goods being carried by sea. So, with that combination of sea trade and finance situated in the city, in the 17th century, a freight derivatives market began. What is now the Baltic Exchange started life in 1744 at the Virginia and Maryland Coffee House in Threadneedle Street. Like many of the early London exchanges, the choice of location reflected its users, merchants and sea captains agreeing prices for transporting goods around the world. A market began in forward freight agreements. These are a form of bilateral over-the-counter, i.e. OTC, forward contracts. Here, one party, the seller, agrees to receive a floating or variable freight rate in exchange for the other party, the buyer, paying a fixed freight rate. Both rates are usually for the same agreed route. The contract then settles at an agreed future date. Other specialized exchanges which traded forward and futures also got going too, including a corn exchange on Mark Lane.
So, we have an active commodity derivatives market, including freight, an FX derivative market, and an equity derivatives market. An explosion in world trade was accompanied by the progression, development, and sophistication of the rule of law. I think that the sophistication of the legal system was something that was missing in the earlier societies. What legal changes were happening to support this?
Going back to my chart, which demonstrated the constituent part of the derivatives contract, in order to have a financial instrument which overlays the underlying asset, you need to have a legal system which supports that. And 18th century England saw several innovations. First was a recognition and trading market in negotiable contracts such as promissory notes, bills of exchange, and bills of lading. Promissory notes in negotiable form are unconditional written promises in writing to pay the holder of a note at a future time. A bill of exchange is a written order from a drawer to a drawee, e.g. a bank, to pay an amount of money to a payee on demand or on a specific date. And a bill of lading is a document issued by a carrier, such as a shipper, which gives details of goods and gives title to the goods to the party named on the bill of lading. In the 18th century, English law progressed to recognise negotiability of these contracts, allowing an assignee to gain the same title as the original holder. This legal jump allowed a tradable basis to exist for derivatives financial instruments, such as options and forwards. In the early part of the 18th century, contracts for differences were recognised too. A thriving derivatives trade continued to develop both in shares and commodities and foreign exchange. So you had the contractual basis present in Britain to contract derivatives with various exchanges, be it the Baltic, the Royal Exchange, or the Corn Exchanges. You had venues where derivatives across underlying classes were traded. Things were thriving, but within a few years, a crisis had brought the first heavy bout of derivatives regulation. And it all started from a financial scandal and crisis.
Yes, some things never change. The South Sea Bubble was perhaps the first of the great financial scandals. A joint stock company called the South Sea Company was launched in 1710. trading on the basis that it would be able to reap the benefits of trading concessions with Spanish America as soon as peace was concluded between Spain and Great Britain. A frenzy soon took hold of investors, with share prices soaring on the expectation that they would soar more, not on the basis of the fundamentals. That's several hundred thousands of pounds of capital invested before the whole system crashes, making fools of many and ruining thousands.
Yes, and derivatives had a hand in fueling the vast increases in that share price. And although there had already been some regulation of short sales before, the South Sea bubble brought major restrictions to derivatives trading with an act brought in by Sir John Barnard. Sir John Barnard was a British Whig politician. He was an MP for almost 40 years from 1722, and he was also Lord Mayor of London for the year 1737. In the aftermath of the South Sea bubble, derivatives trading had continued, but for some years a group of MPs had the practice firmly in their sights, just as their successors did in 2009. Sir John Barnard introduced an Act of Parliament in 1733 called a Bill to Prevent the Infamous Practice of Stock Jobbing. The rhetoric in the Houses of Parliament all seemed vaguely familiar with the Royal Exchange, where much of the trade in share forwards and options took place, described as a gaming house. And that's almost 300 years before the phrase casino banking was coined. Members of the House of Lords, though, feared that trade would be lost to Amsterdam, but nobody then used the phrase regulatory arbitrage. The bill became law in 1734, and it made all puts and refusals relating to the future price of stock and securities null and void, and fined those involved in the trade. The derivatives trade did not die, though. It went underground to the streets and coffee houses near the Royal Exchange and became self-regulated.
So, by 1750, you had the sophistication of proper derivatives trading markets, enforced commercial customs, and a regulated environment, accompanied by a major expansion in trade. Prior to the late 20th century and early 21st century boom, I think that you have the most important phase in the development of a derivatives market. So, let's move to the 19th century. The Industrial Revolution has now transitioned the British economy from an agrarian one to a mainly industrial one. This is a new point in world history. Britain becomes the workshop of the world. And whilst Britain is first, other countries such as Germany are moving in the same direction. This is accompanied and driven too by further development of a financial infrastructure in the City of London and to a lesser degree in other countries.
Yes, the legal system supporting derivatives continued to develop. The restrictions on forward trading of shares officially continued, but this was widely ignored. So although these contracts could not be enforced under law, the participants in the market knew that to fail to fulfill an agreement would result in exclusion from the market. The Sir John Barnard Act was finally repealed in 1860. This meant that it was no longer an offence to contract time bargains for equities. This recognised that there was already a thriving trade in this area at the stock exchange itself, in spite of the ban. Commodity derivatives had never been banned. The legal framework supporting bills of exchange had been established in the previous century, but from that foundation grew a more complex trading infrastructure. Bills of lading were given judicial recognition similar to bills of exchange and found to be just as negotiable. It wasn't all positive though, and the Gaming Act of 1845, which withdrew enforceability of gambling by the courts, affected the derivatives market until recent years.
I've been based in the United States for nearly 30 years now. Don't they have a derivative markets in the 19th century?
Yes, it did, and particularly in commodities. The US courts tended to follow closely the decisions of the English courts, at least that is up until about the middle of the 19th century. However, a number of states did interpret derivatives contracts as wagers, i.e. gambling, making them unenforceable, and in some cases banned forward contracts where the seller was not already in possession of the goods at the time the contract was entered into.
One major development was the establishment of the Chicago Board of Trade in 1848.
Indeed, and it still exists today as part of CME Group. I was looking at the website recently, which stated that its marketplace now handles 3 billion contracts a year and another $1 quadrillion of contracts annually. Back in 1848, a group of 82 grain merchants founded the Chicago Board of Trade. Chicago is located on the shore of Lake Michigan, and the idea of the exchange was to provide a solution to the warehousing and transportation of huge quantities of grain which were arriving from the new settlements in the west of America. Originally, these grain traders met at the Gage and Haynes flour store. As things expanded, the exchange was trading in various other commodity asset classes as well, including coal, wine, pork, and lumber. The Chicago Board of Trade received its charter from the Illinois legislature in 1859, and under this established trading rules, as well as rules for standardizing and grading commodity assets. It was these rules of standardization which allowed a futures market to begin in a whole range of underlying commodity assets. And by 1864, there were a series of trading pits operating at the exchange, trading commodities futures. Similar developments occurred with the establishment in New York of the New York Mercantile Exchange in 1872, which was founded by dairy merchants, and the Chicago Mercantile Exchange, founded in Chicago by butter and egg merchants in 1898.
We've talked about the commodities derivatives in the US, but I remember two stories that you used to tell me over the years on equity derivatives in the United States. The first relates to Cornelius Vanderbilt, and the second to Piggly Wiggly stores.
I've always enjoyed reading about the American Gilded Age. A few years ago, I read a biography of Cornelius Vanderbilt. He was known as the Commodore, and he was a self-made businessman who created a tremendous fortune from putting together various railroad and shipping interests. And in fact, he made enough money during his lifetime to make him one of the richest Americans who ever lived. The Commodore was regularly involved in battles for control of corporations. And in 1857, he became embroiled in a battle to wrestle control of the New York and Harlem Railroad. This line was one of only two which had direct access to Manhattan, and the Commodore began to buy up shares at between $8 and $15. The share price started to rise and rise, and one of the main reasons for this was the likelihood that the City Council of New York would authorize the line to build a streetcar franchise along the length of Manhattan. It would be the only line able to do this, and in anticipation, the shares shot up to $75. A rival of the Commodore, Daniel Drew, approached key members of the council and showed them that if they did not authorize the new franchise, then the share price would crash, and that this presented a fantastic opportunity to short the shares, i.e. to enter into contract to purchase the shares and agree to sell them back to the original seller at the same price in a future period of time for a fee. The council members would sell the shares immediately and then reap huge profits, buying them back at the crash prices before reselling them at the original price to complete the short sale. The council members and a group of speculators and other financiers began buying up the shares and shorting them with vigor. Vanderbilt, on the other hand, used his financial muscle to purchase these shares as they flooded the market. A bill was passed authorizing the streetcar line, but it was soon rescinded by the city council. The council members, and most others, in fact, thought that the shares would then plummet, and through derivatives, the short sales, they would make a fortune. But they didn't. The Harlem shares soared, reaching $106. Vanderbilt and his associates had acquired all of the outstanding shares in Harlem. There were no shares left to return as part of the short contracts. This left the council members facing financial disaster. The share prices went up and up to $180 before the council relented and reverted to reauthorizing the streetcar franchise. Vanderbilt himself made $5 million from this episode and amazingly was able to repeat the exercise for even greater profit some years later.
Yes, and it wasn't just Commodore Vanderbilt who engaged in this behavior.
Yes, I'm going to read an abstract from an article called A Corner in Piggly Wiggly, which was published in the New Yorker on June 6, 1959. Clarence Sanders of Memphis in 1919 founded Piggly Wiggly Stores, a chain of retail self-service markets situated mainly in the South and West with headquarters in Memphis. Saunders is remembered on Wall Street as the last man who engineered a real corner in a nationally traded stock. By 1922, the stores had flourished so that its shares were listed on the New York Stock Exchange. When a group of bears began selling Piggly Wiggly short to force the price of the stock down, Saunders began a buying campaign to support the price of the stock in order to protect his own investment and that of other Piggly Wiggly stockholders. He supplemented his own funds with a loan of about $10 million from a group of bankers. His buying campaign was an attempt at a corner. The stock went up wildly, reaching a high of $124. At this point, the New York Stock Exchange, though, suspended further trading and postponed the short seller's delivery deadline. So, not everyone could match the Commodore. Although I note that Piggly Wiggly Stores feature heavily in Driving Miss Daisy, which also stars Dan Aykroyd, another feather in his derivatives acting cap. I think, though, that because we had the rule of law and negotiability of contracts together with commercial sophistication, we had the ingredients for a derivatives market to take off in 19th century and early 20th century America. Commodore Vanderbilt and Piggly Wiggly provide colorful stories, but for what happened to have happened, we needed an active and liquid derivatives market. In these two cases, in the equity derivatives market.
Then as now, I can see why there was a need for regulation.
Indeed, and the late 20th century and 21st century has seen an explosion both in derivatives products and derivatives regulation.
So tell me a little bit more about the course of derivatives after Vanderbilt.
Let's stay with the United States for a moment. Futures exchanges popped up around the country. The New York Cotton Exchange was founded in 1871. The Milwaukee Chamber of Commerce, which traded agricultural futures, was founded in 1861. And the New York Gold Exchange, which traded gold futures, was founded in 1864. There were some obstacles, though. The Civil War caused considerable disruption. Also, Massachusetts banned forwards and futures contracts where the seller did not have ownership of the asset sold in a case in 1871. This was followed by a number of cases and legislative acts at state level outlawing speculative derivatives contracts. Mississippi, Tennessee, South Carolina, and Arkansas, as well as several other states, all made these contracts illegal or unenforceable. While some states restricted the trade, New York and Chicago continued with strong growth, with the New York Produce Exchanges and New York Coffee Exchange performing well. In the 20th century, futures began to be regulated at federal level, with the Cotton Futures Act of 1916 making trading in cotton futures economically difficult with a series of levies, taxes, and other restrictions. This was followed in 1921 by the soon overturned Futures Trading Act, which placed a heavy tax on grain futures, and a Grain Futures Act in 1922. Following the Great Depression, proper federal regulation of derivative trading in the United States arrived with the Commodity Exchange Act of 1936. This introduced segregation of customer assets by future commission merchants, registration of merchants and brokers, and a series of federal oversight provisions. This act was given further teeth in 1868. Further regulatory powers came about in the Commodities Future Trading Commission Act in 1974. Regulation of commodity futures was offered up to the SEC at this point, but the SEC declined to accept this mandate, and instead a new body, the Commodities Futures Trading Commission, was introduced. That's now the CFTC. Those viewers who have been spending their time on Dodd-Frank matters over the last few years will appreciate the significance of this moment. I've spoken a lot about what happened in the US during this period, but what about the UK? Well, we didn't see much in the way of regulatory restriction in the same period, but the markets quietly grew. Yes, there were various regulatory changes, but the city largely regulated itself in this period with the support of the courts and of English law. Well, I'm going to stop at 1983, at the point of the release of the Trading Places movie. The history since then, the birth and establishment of ISDA, of structured securities and derivatives, the financial crisis, central clearing, global regulation, credit derivatives, etc., etc. That deserves another episode in itself.
Not so fast. We started with Trading Places. We're going to finish with Trading Places. I would like to point out that the film had a much more effect than you are giving credit for. I'm going to read a quote from Gary Gensler, the recent CFTC chairman, giving testimony to Congress in the United States in 2010. "We have recommended banning using misappropriated government information to trade in the commodity markets. In the movie Trading Places, starring Eddie Murphy, the Duke brothers intended to profit from trades in frozen concentrated orange juice futures contracts, using an illicitly obtained and not yet public Department of Agriculture orange crop report. Characters played by Eddie Murphy and Dan Aykroyd intercept the misappropriated report and trade on it to profit and ruin the Duke brothers. In real life, using such misappropriated government information actually is not illegal. To protect our markets, we've recommended what we call the Eddie Murphy rule to ban insider trading using non-public information misappropriated from a government source. The Eddie Murphy provision is now set out at Section 746 of the Dodd-Frank Act."